Get off my fucking TV and save me the misery. And all you fucking goons, just grab a cold beer. The man of the hour is finally here. J.D. from New York, 206. It's time for Off the Script. J.D. from New York, 206. It's time for Off the Script.
What is going on, guys? J.D. from New York here. Is the number one fucking podcast in your subscription boxes right here on YouTube.com. This is Off the Script, episode 130, part number two for your Saturday, August 13th, 2016. Man, thank you guys so much for all your continued love and support of what I do right here on this channel, man. You guys are fucking unbelievable. A few things I do want to go over. Number one, I'm glad you guys just liked my silliness of yesterday's intro, because I knew people were going to be like, oh, JD, you shaved your beard, man. I knew that was coming, so I figured I'd poke a little fun and have some fun with it. But I hope you guys enjoyed what we did yesterday with a nice little cameo from Keemstar, unadvertised, by the way. But I'm glad you guys enjoyed that nonetheless, man. I do want to say, if you guys are getting ready for SummerSlam, I know I am going to be with Mr. Justin Labar all weekend. As soon as he gets here on SummerSlam Sunday, I believe he's going to be in town until Tuesday. But he is inviting me to join him SummerSlam afternoon. And if you guys are in Brooklyn, if you guys live in Brooklyn, if you guys are going to be in and out of Brooklyn or in and around Brooklyn, SummerSlam Sunday, that's the 21st of August. I will be in Brooklyn all day long. What I plan on doing is I am going to try and go to the meet and greet that Solid Monster has for SummerSlam. I believe he's going to have Bill Apter there. He's going to be there with a bunch of his fans, and they're going to be drinking. I don't know what the bar or the name of the bar is that they're all meeting up at, but I'm going to try and attend that. And then Labar is filming something in Manhattan, I believe from 2 to 3, and he's going to be in Brooklyn from 4 to 6 hosting an event. I'm going to be there right alongside of him, and we're going to be at 205th. It's an American sports bar. I believe it's like 2 or 3 blocks from the Barclays Center. And I am going to be there with Labar from 4 to 6 p.m. So if you guys want to come and say hello, if you're in and around Brooklyn and you want to just shake hands and make acquaintances and call me a fucking goon, whatever the fucking case may be, man, I'll be wearing my Roman Reigns Get Off My TV t-shirt. The Eve Marie one apparently is not up for sale as of yet. Otherwise, I would have loved to have that for SummerSlam weekend. In and around Brooklyn, showcasing the worst of them all, Eve Marie. That would have been fantastic. But Roman Reigns will do. Roman Reigns will do. But I will be at 205th. It's an American sports bar in Brooklyn. It's a couple blocks away from the Barclays Center. I believe Labar is going to SummerSlam. I'm going to be heading home after that. I want to watch it in the comfort of my own home with my brother. And then obviously bring you guys a review. I don't think there's any possibility that I could go to SummerSlam or possibly get backstage or something along those lines. Even if that was the case, I would probably want to watch it at home because I want my brother to watch it. He doesn't want to go into work Monday morning not watching it because it is SummerSlam. And we usually make a yearly tradition out of these big pay-per-views, and he likes watching it with me. And then obviously I'm going to do the review for you guys, and I'm going to be planning content all Sunday morning and afternoon, getting you guys ready for SummerSlam literally in every way possible. Match simulations with 2K16 and news and rumors, late breaking news and rumors, the last minute news and rumors right before the event goes live on the network. So that's what's going on right now. That's the plan for Sunday. So if you guys are in and around Brooklyn, 205th, I will be with Labar, Justin Labar of WrestleZone.com, and Trib Live Radio, the beast himself. And we'll be doing the fucking WWE thing, man. I don't know what's going to happen, but we're going to host some type of event where I'm going to be there. just hanging around. So if you guys want to come say hello, I will be there from 4 to 6 p.m. Anyway, guys, the usual shit. T-shirts, barbershop window. You guys know what to do. If you guys want to get your own T-shirts, it's a great way to support the show. The new Eva Marie T-shirt will hopefully be up by the end of the weekend. I will let you guys know immediately when that beauty goes on sale. If you guys want to donate and support the show in another way, I have my Patreon account. That's patreon.com/JDFromNY206. I urge you all to read the mission statement on there, man. I want you guys to understand why I'm doing this, and if you feel compelled to pledge and donate, please feel free to do so. It's not obligated, but if you guys want to, it is there for you guys. That's patreon.com/JDFromNY206. Follow me on Twitter at JDFromNY206 and subscribe to the YouTube channel if you guys are not doing so already. I don't know what the fuck you are waiting for, man. This show is going to become the face of the IWC before you even know it, man. So make sure you guys are subscribed right here for Off the Script every single weekend, plus so much more WWE-related content right here on YouTube.com. My friends over at WrestleCrate, WrestleCrate.com, and on Twitter, at WrestleCrate. Coupon code JD sent me for an instant 10% off. Wrestle Rumble and the SummerSlam Pick'em is coming, man. So make sure you guys visit WrestleRumble.com. First prize is $750 plus any T-shirt you want from Pro Wrestling Tees. Off the script. Being that it's Pro Wrestling Tees related, we're not on the actual website, but I think they'll make an exception if you guys want to get my T-shirt and you guys are one of the top three, to pretty much place in the top three to win cash money during Wrestle Rumble, man. WrestleRumble.com. I'm going to be in it. Put your knowledge to the test. Have some fun with it. SummerSlam, going to be entertaining. Why not make it more entertaining and win cash money at the end of it all using your wrestling knowledge, man? And we will be doing preview and predictions on Out of Nowhere. I'm going to try and get good mic work and his knowledge on Out of Nowhere. I'm going to try and set that up with Joe. I know Joe wasn't feeling well for Out of Nowhere this week. He's been under a lot of stress, just like everybody else, but his job is killing him. He didn't get home till about 12:30 that night. He fucking passed out when he got home. That's the reason there was no Out of Nowhere. But I'm going to try and get good mic work on Wednesday so we can talk about SummerSlam in depth. So make sure you guys tune in to that good mic work on Out of Nowhere. And then I was going to mention something else, but I completely fucking forgot. And then, yes, the preview and predictions for SummerSlam, that's coming on Off the Script Friday. We're going to do an NXT preview and predictions as well, probably Thursday or Friday of that week as well, leading into the pay-per-view events. So much shit coming up, man. You guys want to stay tuned for whatever I got planned for this channel, so make sure you guys are subscribed, man. Let's get into the news and rumors. A lot of stuff to go over. We got big stories all across the board concerning Brock Lesnar and Vince McMahon and Finn Balor. Bunch of shit leading into SummerSlam, man, so let's get right into the news and rumors right here on Off the Script. Episode 130, part number 2 for your Saturday morning. Brock Lesnar to challenge for the WWE Universal title at the Royal Rumble in 2017. Now, I know this sounds a little bit far-fetched, and we're only in August 2016. We're not even at SummerSlam yet. But this is legitimately being talked about, and in my honest opinion, it does make sense. Just in the fact that Brock Lesnar was a draft pick, is a draft pick for Monday Night Raw. WWE's obviously going to want to use him and legitimize that draft pick, even though he is a part-timer. They're going to use him in some way, shape, or form. Why not be as a challenger for the WWE Universal Championship? And Brock Lesnar's going to be in something big. We just don't know what yet for WrestleMania 33. So this very well may be true in 2017. 3 weeks after the WWE draft and the self-proclaimed new era of WWE, the SummerSlam lineup is already looking promising. Charlotte is getting her rematch against Sasha Banks for the WWE Women's Championship. Banks defeated Charlotte on WWE Raw 3 weeks ago to win the belt in Pittsburgh. It's being considered as one of the best matches of the year already, and there is still 4 months left to go. The WWE Tag Team Championships are also on the line as the New Day defends their titles against The Club, Gallows, and Anderson. It will be The Club's first legitimate chance at the prestigious titles with Big E out with a storyline injury, ring post-itis, injury to his cock and his balls, if you guys have not been paying attention, that immediately lessens the chance for the New Day to retain. They already set the WWE record for the longest tag team title reign. If it were to happen at SummerSlam, it would be a great place to drop the belts. Now, before I even continue the story, I honestly thought WWE was going to set up a dynamic of face versus face, New Day versus Enzo and Cass, but obviously they want to keep it old school. I would not be shocked if the club win the titles and then go on to drop them to Enzo and Cass. I guess WWE wants to keep it old school with that heel-face dynamic heading into the remainder of 2016 when it comes to the Tag Team Championships. I thought that it would be a great passing of the torch if the New Day did it and dropped the belts to Enzo and Cass in Brooklyn, and they now are the face of that division, deservedly so, because they're the hottest tag team in all of WWE. On SmackDown Live 3 weeks ago, Dolph Ziggler became the number one contender to Dean Ambrose's WWE World Championship. Also on SmackDown Live, they showcased the rematch between John Cena and AJ Styles, which both men have done a great job of promoting. Chris Jericho and Kevin Owens are set to take on Enzo and Big Cass. Roman Reigns is getting his redemption against Rusev for the United States title. Apollo Crews will get his first shot at the Intercontinental title and The Miz. And then obviously, in the night's main event, Finn Balor takes on Seth Rollins for the WWE Universal title. All that said and done, SummerSlam is, on paper, a pretty damn fucking impressive card. Amongst all those great matches, WWE fans may be looking forward to Brock Lesnar and Randy Orton more than anything at SummerSlam. Most of the matches I just mentioned are easy to predict, but this one is different. It could honestly go either way, but the best part of this match is what is being speculated to happen in the months to come. According to NoDQ.com, Brock Lesnar is expected to fight for the WWE Universal title at the Royal Rumble. So if it happens, fantastic. If it doesn't happen, please blame Aaron Rift. Okay? That's all you gotta know. Take it with a grain of salt, but if it happens, great. If not, it's Aaron Rift's fault. The early plan for next year's Royal Rumble event is reportedly for Brock Lesnar to challenge the holder of the WWE Universal Championship. Apparently, Brock Lesnar will be challenging whoever holds the title at the Royal Rumble, which is going to be a pivotal way to establish Raw's biggest feuds heading into WrestleMania 33 in Orlando. I don't know if that would be Finn Balor. I can't imagine a Finn Balor versus Brock Lesnar match. I mean, that's just completely bizarre. I don't see Finn Balor even fucking making it down the aisleway with Brock Lesnar staring face to face. So I don't know if that's going to happen or not. More than likely, it could be Seth Rollins or someone that we don't know of. I don't know. I don't know what's going on, but this is what is being reported by NoDQ.com. If this is the plan moving forward, okay, then Lesnar, no question, is winning at SummerSlam. There's no fucking way you're going to have him lose to Orton because of a bullshit drug failure from the USADA and have him go in here and lose and then promote him to a WWE Universal Championship match at the Royal Rumble. And you know the WWE is going to make the Universal Championship, even though it's not, deep down it's not. They are going to make it seem more important than the WWE Championship because it is on Monday Night Raw. You know that's coming. You know that is coming in the way WWE plans all this shit out. So if that's the case, why would they have Lesnar lose to Orton? A loss to Lesnar here does nothing for Randy Orton. Nothing. He goes in there, he looks good against the Beast, he loses. Every man that has stepped in that ring before him has suffered the same fate. Cena, The Undertaker. That's all you need to know, man. That's all you need to know. If Orton loses against Lesnar at SummerSlam, it's not going to damage Orton in any way. It's just going to... It's just going to be one of those things where he went in there in a war, in a battle, and he came out on the losing end, just like everybody else. That's all. There's nothing to be ashamed of there. Lesnar is a surefire winner at SummerSlam if this report from NoDQ.com is legit. Right now, some are saying Orton is doing some of the best work of his career. I don't know where they're getting that from. I think that's just fucking people talking. Randy Orton as a face is disgusting. I like his work as a heel. I don't see why that comment was being uttered by anybody. While his segment at WWE Payback with Chris Jericho was a success, his true RKO out of nowhere is what put him over the hump with the WWE Universe. He's always been a semi-controversial figure in WWE, and the jump from heel to face was consistent over the years. This time, it feels different, much like Jericho's current run. It has a special type of aura surrounding it, and Randy Orton is no longer the controversial figure in this feud, as it is Brock Lesnar and the negative press that he has been engulfed in with his name in the mainstream media. In an earlier report by several sources, including The Inquisitor, it is being rumored that WWE superstars were not happy with Lesnar after he was found not guilty to the WWE wellness policy. The aftermath of the failed drug test for the UFC simply didn't help his stock within the company. He's already one of the most hated part-time wrestlers in the business. Lesnar's agenda is to come in for big matches and feuds, collect his paycheck, and go back home and hunt deer. That's pretty much what Brock Lesnar does. He does whatever the fuck he wants. It's either a UFC return or go back to hunt near his home. Lesnar is a polarizing figure in the WWE. Excuse me, by the way, goons. I don't know what the fuck. It must have been something I ate this afternoon. UFC and sports altogether. Even if fans aren't a fan of his antics, he still brings in big money for the WWE. His match with Orton will be a must-see event, no matter the victor. It looks like Lesnar's stock after that match won't matter when the Royal Rumble comes around in January 2017. I've been saying this all along, man, to be completely honest with you. And I'm not going to dive into this too much because I don't want to fucking beat a dead horse. Lesnar should not lose. Plain and simple. Lesnar should not lose, period. Unless this is Lesnar on the final day of his contract and it's solid, concrete information that he is never to appear in the WWE ever again and he's going to be inducted into the Hall of Fame and he's done completely. That's when you have a Lesnar loss. A loss to Randy Orton is not what is best for business right now. I don't give a fuck how many mistakes Lesnar has made. He could have walked right into New York City during SummerSlam weekend in Times Square and fucking break somebody's arm with a Kimura lock on 42nd Street and 7th Avenue with fucking a mass exodus of people watching. He can legit fucking kill somebody in cold blood. And WWE will not do anything about it because it's fucking Brock Lesnar. Seriously. That's just the way Brock Lesnar operates. That's what happens when you sign Brock Lesnar and a character and a beast like Brock Lesnar. I'm sorry, this is not me kissing his ass or stroking his cock. This is not me doing any of those things. This is common sense and logic. Okay? The reason why you cannot have Lesnar lose to Randy Orton is because, number one, it makes no fucking sense. Orton coming back, whether this is his first match back after a year and a half, I don't give a fuck if he's been out for 10 years. You don't make Randy Orton win his return match against Brock Lesnar. I feel like this match was just fucking thrown together anyway. It feels like WWE took a fucking stick of gum that Mr. Perfect chewed in the fucking 1990s, still sticky and still wet, and fucking chucked that shit across the fucking room during a creative meeting, and it landed on Randy Orton's fucking picture across the wall. Oh, okay, we'll just put Brock Lesnar in a match with Randy Orton! There you go! Instead of having a solid concrete idea about who they really want him to face at SummerSlam. So I feel like it's just random anyway. It just feels random. Feels like WWE had no plan going into this at all. You know, maybe 1 week, 2 weeks before they actually announced that Lesnar's opponent was going to be announced before UFC 200. So I wouldn't have him lose based on that alone, period, number one. Number two, the most important thing out of everything is you got to keep the majestic feel of The Undertaker's undefeated WrestleMania streak alive. You know, it's like, I don't know, I'm going to use a Zelda reference again. It's like fucking Brock Lesnar going into the Lost Woods and finding the Master Sword, right? You know, if you guys play Zelda, if you guys are a fucking video game geek like I am, Brock Lesnar walks into the fucking Lost Woods, you know, looking for the Master Sword. He hears the fucking flute in the distance, you know, and he knows he's getting closer, and then you see some fucking big-eared goon, some fucking midget troll on a tree stump somewhere, and he's just playing the flute, and you see fucking notes coming out, right? Lesnar knows he's getting close. The Master Sword is within distance. And then Lesnar finally finds the Master Sword and is the only one to wield its fucking magical powers. He's the only one to pull it from its slab of rock, right? He's the only one to fucking release that beast from the ground. That's Lesnar. That is Lesnar. Lesnar holds the power. Lesnar holds the power in WWE. You're going to waste that power on Randy Orton? You fucking out of your mind? That's like Lesnar getting the Master Sword and fighting Ganon after leveling it up, and you got fucking 24 hearts of fucking full power and energy, and you got fucking magical powers coming out of the Master Sword, all different types of directions, and you go into a fucking battle with Ganondorf, or whoever the fuck they got, one of his fucking right-hand magicians, and Lesnar fucking falls instantly. You can't have that happen. That's not the way to do things. This is the Undertaker you're talking about. That streak, and that winning streak, and the power that came from that will never be duplicated. And if it is, we won't be alive to see it. Cannot happen. Cannot happen. Lesnar holds the power. You understand? So, being that he wields this power, you're going to go into SummerSlam and have him lose because of a fucking drug violation? Come on, bro. Petty. Absolutely petty. Like I said, Lesnar could fucking walk into New York and kill somebody in cold blood. I wouldn't suspend him. I wouldn't even arrest him. He's fucking Brock Lesnar. Anyway. What do you do with Lesnar then? Do you have him win the Universal title? Do you have him challenge for the Universal title? Yeah, you have someone fuck him over. You know? You have someone fuck him over. You know? I wouldn't have him lose. I wouldn't have him lose in any way. Not by a DQ, not by a countout, certainly not by a pinfall. You know, someone fucks Lesnar over at retaining another major title in WWE. Who would I have Lesnar lose to? Well, there's only two men in my book. Samoa Joe. I mentioned this already. Samoa Joe would be the only one right now, believably, in WWE to bring him to a match that is going to be absolutely as realistic as possible. Or, and yes, goons, it could happen because they've met before overseas, Shinsuke Nakamura. If you want to make Shinsuke Nakamura the beast that he needs to be in WWE, and you want to legitimize him instantly in WWE, why not have him Kinshasa Brock Lesnar at WrestleMania? Makes sense to me. I don't know about you clowns, but it makes sense to me for sure. And then, if Lesnar is really done and Heyman is still contracted to WWE, why not have Heyman be Nakamura's new spokesman? Because obviously he speaks English, but not too well. You're not going to get across what Nakamura is going to try and get across without a good mic man, you know, without good mic skills. He can't do it on his own. You know, a few words here and there, I can understand them, but with Paul Heyman by his side, I think that would be fucking fantastic. Heyman and Nakamura. I don't know. We'll see what happens. Speaking of that, big backstage update on Paul Heyman's future and potential Paul Heyman guys. Lesnar will wrestle another match before Triple H, The Undertaker, or Shane McMahon, a clear indication of how WrestleMania has changed the landscape in the WWE recently. So there was Brock alongside Heyman selling SummerSlam in a showdown against Randy Orton as if nothing had changed, and on screen, little actually had. Fans know the deal by now. The WWE and Brock Lesnar have agreed to a deal that allows the Beast to work a limited schedule and earn maximum pay. And Heyman is there to sell his client and his client's latest feuds to the masses, and he does it better than anybody. However, The Advocate came extremely close to missing out on a match billed as 15 years in the making. Everything is fucking 15 years in the making. Your mother's fucking recipe that she's cooking me tomorrow night is 15 years in the making because she found the recipe buried underneath some fucking boxes in the basement, and she wanted to cook me fucking dinner before she actually gave me a blowjob. There you go. How you like that one? Anyway, 15 years in the making before The Beast and the Viper. Last week, several sources reported that Heyman agreed to a new contract with the WWE just hours before Monday Night Raw. There were conflicting feelings inside WWE headquarters in regards to Heyman, with some believing he'd always be back for the SummerSlam build, and others who felt he might not be back at all. I don't know why they would think that. Heyman wants to work. He was being paid per appearance. He wanted a legit contract. He wanted to know, listen, I am worth this, give it to me. And WWE had no choice. Okay, Mr. Heyman, here you go. Because if they didn't, they'd be a bunch of fucking clowns. Heyman is worth every fucking penny, if not more, than what he's making now. Because you don't find talent like that anywhere. And Heyman is probably the best in the business out of everybody on the microphone, especially selling a fucking match. Heyman can fucking sell me or can sell ice to a fucking Eskimo. That's how great he fucking is, man. Unbelievable. Don't know why people thought he would not be back at all. Heyman was looking for a substantial raise while the WWE wasn't willing to budge much. Well, fuck them. Cheap. Things were at an impasse until Brock Lesnar urged the WWE to get it done. So then it was. So there you go. Lesnar, all he's got to do is fucking chime in. Get it done. Can you imagine Lesnar looking at somebody fucking overlooking a fucking desk? Signing a contract. Get it done, Vince. Okay, Mr. Lesnar. Okay, Mr. Lesnar. Cowering in fear. That's what Brock Lesnar does. Now, with Heyman officially back in the fold, it had also been reported that Heyman would have worked several dates without a contract. Daily Wrestling News is reporting that WWE will use him for more dates, but he's also requested to have more creative input into his storylines. Ooh, very important. Very important. This likely comes as good news to WWE fans who watched Heyman help SmackDown overcome Raw during the last brand extension in terms of storylines and overall creativity. It should be worth noting that Heyman wanted to be paid more. He also wanted to work more dates to justify the pay increase. Well, there you go. He wants to work for his money. Good for him. You know? He might be a stingy Jew, but he wants to fucking work for his money. Ever since he became exclusive to Lesnar, he's only worked with a handful of dates more than his client, and therein lies a potential for something bigger. Internally, there has been discussion prior to the WWE draft to make more Paul Heyman guys to help with the brand extension. Clearly, they've held off on any of those plans as of yet, and Heyman will focus mainly on his managerial duties of Lesnar and his program with Randy Orton. But there are two factors that could potentially lead Heyman to serve in a similar role to another superstar or superstars. First, it's expected that Lesnar will take another hiatus after SummerSlam or shortly thereafter. And the second is that back to Heyman's interests, having more say in angles that he's involved in, Heyman has reportedly pitched the idea of being the mouthpiece for either Samoa Joe or Shinsuke Nakamura once they are promoted to the main roster. I'm okay with either one of them, more so Nakamura. I don't think Joe needs a mouthpiece. I think Joe, the way he is right now in NXT, is absolutely brilliant. Joe can get by on his own as a legitimate threat, but Nakamura for sure. It's debatable whether Joe or Nakamura would even need Heyman in their corner, but it's likely that a potential pairing would immediately elevate them into the main event conversation. Things didn't quite work out for Cesaro, Curtis Axel, or Ryback when they were aligned with Heyman, but outside of Ryback's second feud with CM Punk, their booking remained in the mid-card. It won't be long before Samoa Joe and Shinsuke Nakamura get called up from NXT, but with Finn Balor already up, the plan was to wait until NXT had stars ready to carry the flag, waiting behind Joe and Nakamura. Will a Balor-sized push be waiting for their arrivals? Remains to be seen. There's been plenty of buzz surrounding a Brock-Samoa Joe match, with many believing it's even WrestleMania-worthy. Absolutely. Add Paul Heyman to the mix, and things could get extremely interesting. You know, not everybody is going to work as a Paul Heyman guy. In fact, you had a few that were mentioned here, Cesaro and Curtis Axel and Ryback. They were mentioned here. And the thing with that is WWE really fucked all of that up on their own. I don't blame it really on the talent. I blame it on WWE not knowing how to utilize the talent that they put with Paul Heyman. Now, I don't know how much creative control Paul Heyman has over a certain superstar that he worked with in the past, but as you guys know, Cesaro, the most notable name out of all three of those guys, was plucked from a organic growth of a tag team with Jack Swagger. And he was taken out of a situation in which he was getting organically over, naturally over with the crowd. And they put him with Paul Heyman and completely fucked up everything. Now, why would you do that to Cesaro? Unless WWE has something against Cesaro and they're looking to just fucking stick it to him. I don't really get that. And to me, and I'm sure some of you guys think the same way, Cesaro, ever since that moment in which he was a tag team with Jack Swagger and they had Zeb Coulter and they were the real Americans, and they just had this flow to them, and they had this aura to them, they had this feel to them, in which you knew it was going to lead to something special. People were legit giving these guys a reaction that they've never seen before. I mean, people started coming to the crowds with Cesaro section signs. He was organically getting over on his own. and WWE, for whatever reason they might not like it, I still don't understand why they don't like that for a performer. If he's not a guy that they're not willing to push, or if he's a guy that they're not, they don't have plans to push in that way, why they frown upon that type of reaction for a superstar? I mean, if he's going out there and getting that type of reaction, to me, from the way I see it, he's going above and beyond what is called of him. People want to see Cesaro and Jack Swagger, or at least they wanted to, in the midst of that tag team run that they had. No question in my mind that they were going to be tag team champions. WWE didn't even give them the opportunity to see tag team gold. They killed that gimmick and they killed that team quicker than you can fucking breathe. And I don't understand why. People wanted it, but WWE did not give it to us. They gave us Daniel Bryan. Obviously, you cannot compare the two situations because Daniel Bryan is one of the most over WWE superstars of all time. It was something that was not going to go unheard. And everybody voiced their opinion because they knew it was time for Daniel Bryan. They knew the WWE was making a colossal mistake pushing Batista. And Batista as a babyface when he should have been heel. He left as a heel. He should have came in as a heel. And he wanted to be a heel. But they wanted, or Vince McMahon wanted, Batista versus Randy Orton for whatever god, whatever fucking ungodly reason he wanted that as the main event for WrestleMania 30. I don't know. But it was too big of a situation, and the crowd knew, and the people knew, the audience, the WWE Universe knew that the WWE was making a huge mistake by not putting Daniel Bryan where he needed to be. And they voiced their opinion. It was too loud for the WWE to ignore. And Cesaro was slowly accumulating that every single week. It was getting too loud for the WWE to ignore. So they thought that, okay, we can take Cesaro out of here and take him out of this successful situation, and he's organically, naturally getting over on his own. Okay, we'll take what he has done and we'll put our spin on it. They put him with Paul Heyman. Now, in anybody's right mind, if you put somebody with Paul Heyman, they're naturally going to get over. It doesn't work that way. It would have worked that way if Paul Heyman wasn't coming out proclaiming that Brock Lesnar just beat The Undertaker's undefeated streak every single fucking week. Because you took Cesaro, who was naturally getting over as a babyface and someone that people wanted to see, and you automatically put him with a genuinely, clearly, no distinguished at all. You know, it's not that hard to decipher that Paul Heyman was heel or face. He was heel. You take a face and you put him with a heel manager who's been saying, listen, my client just beat The Undertaker's undefeated streak, getting under people's skin every single fucking week, proclaiming it every single Monday Night Raw. That didn't make any sense. You ultimately killed what Cesaro had built up for himself, and he never was able to recover that. He was never able to recover from that at all. And that was WWE's mistake. Because for whatever reason, they don't like talent organically getting over. I don't know. I mean, if I was a COO or a CEO or someone in creative, that's half the fucking battle won. That's half the fucking battle won there. If someone can go out there and organically get that type of reaction to the people or for the people to throw their money to buy tickets, to come and cheer this guy, whereas he was not getting this type of reactions a few months prior to this tag team with Jack Swagger. Something went right for Cesaro, and WWE did not want it to happen. Or they did want it to happen, but they were like, ah, this is not what we planned, so we're going to take what he has already accomplished here, and we're going to put our own little fucking recipe on top. And they ultimately fucking put the shit in the oven and they burned the motherfucker straight to the ground. Didn't work out. And they fucked up not only Jack Swagger, but they fucked up Cesaro. Jack Swagger hasn't been anything relevant since. Cesaro, you know, you got little glimpses of greatness here and there, and you know he's ready to fucking break out if WWE allows him to. Still, to this very day, holding the man back. Obviously, not everybody is a Paul Heyman guy. But in that certain situation, it was not Heyman's fault. It was not Cesaro's fault. It was WWE's neglect of letting Cesaro just run. Curtis Axel, to me, one of the more talented mid-card performers they could have in the company. They just don't give him anything to do. They don't want to give him anything to do. They're content with giving him a fucking social outcast gimmick. This is the son of Mr. Perfect. It is not that difficult to book someone who is the son and of the bloodline of Mr. Perfect. I don't know. Crazy as that might sound to WWE, it is very, very simple. Axel's got the in-ring skill. He's got the look. He's got the mic skill. He's got the intensity. And when I look at Curtis Axel in the ring, I do see glimpses of his father. Why they don't pay homage and respect to what Mr. Perfect has done for that company and how great he was of a performer and live vicariously through his son, Mr. Perfect was taken from us far too soon. You have his son here. Utilize it. Hone it. Craft it. Give it to us. You got a new generation of fucking fans here who might not even know who Mr. Perfect was. Is. Hall of Famer. I've had people come to me, and I've had people say, JD, this was a couple of days ago on Twitter. JD, you posted a 1993 King of the Ring clip on your Twitter. And I'm watching Mr. Perfect versus Bret the Hitman Hart. Probably my favorite match that those two have ever had. One of my favorite King of the Ring matches ever. And he told me in this tweet he's never watched a King of the Ring before 1999. I'm like, how can you not watch a King of the Ring before 1999? 1993 was the epitome of what a pay-per-view should be for the WWE. He didn't understand that. He went back and watched it, instantly fell in love with everything that event was. You had Macho Man, you had Bobby the Brain, you had Jim Ross on commentary, you had the entire environment and the aura of that King of the Ring tournament and the story that was told through that 8-man tournament in that single night. Perfectly told with every match that Bret Hart fought that night leading up to the sneak attack or the fucking brutal attack that Jerry the King Lawler gave him at the end of that fucking ceremony. He didn't know of that event. He went back and watched that Mr. Perfect match, and needless to say, he knew what he was watching. Greatness. Why can't we live vicariously through what Mr. Perfect tried to do and was taken from us well too soon and live it through his son? Offer us what we cannot have any longer in Mr. Perfect through Curtis Axel. I mean, give me a break. It's not that fucking difficult to book someone with the lineage and the bloodline of one of the greatest of all time. They did the same thing with fucking Ted DiBiase. Now, Ted DiBiase, to me, was, I think, on the lesser scale of what a Curtis Axel is or a Cody Rhodes. I think honestly, Ted DiBiase lacked personality. He was the complete polar opposite of what his father was. The Million Dollar Man was one of the greatest characters ever created in WWE. Ted DiBiase was a one-of-a-kind character. You know, they tried that same shtick with Ted DiBiase Jr., and it didn't work because he did not have the personality. He was not his father. He would never amount to becoming his father. And some say, you know, he doesn't have to be the same thing that his father was, but he just lacked personality. Curtis Axel does not lack personality. Curtis Axel has personality. Curtis Axel has in-ring skill. He has the look. So did Cody Rhodes. Cody Rhodes had all that. But WWE did not know what to do with any of these guys. And still don't know what to do with Curtis Axel. As he's the only one out of the three who still is employed by WWE. What I mean to say here without fucking ranting too much longer is WWE wants things to happen on their own time. You know? They want things to happen because they approve of it. Cesaro's huge face turn with Jack Swagger was not planned by WWE. But as an outsider looking inside, I've seen many more positives to come out of that and barely any negatives. And they made everything about that situation a negative because they put Cesaro with Paul Heyman. Not everybody needs a Paul Heyman guy. Or not everybody needs to be a Paul Heyman guy, I should say. Cesaro had swagger, a huge reaction every time he came out. That music just fucking made people go crazy. Zeb Coulter fit perfectly with both of those guys. And WWE fucked it all up. You could have had one of the better tag teams that we've seen in recent memory. With a nice couple of runs as tag team champions, and they didn't want it. What I'm trying to say here is WWE is to blame more times than not for ruining something that could have been special. Curtis Axel, Cesaro, they're the ones to blame. The talent is not to blame. They're told to go out there and do exactly what they're told to do. And it sucks. It sucks. Because we've been void and we've been neglected of something that could have been great. Or because WWE didn't want it. I don't like hearing that. I don't like hearing that type of shit, man. It really fucking irks me as a fan. The things that should have been done, but were not. I don't know. Let me know what you guys think about that. But Nakamura, Joe, more so Nakamura as a Paul Heyman guy. I don't think, like I said previously, I don't think Joe needs Paul Heyman. I mean, the look would be there. I would not mind if it happened. But Samoa Joe can more than handle his own. He doesn't need a spokesman to do his battles or fight his battles or talk his way out of battles. Joe can talk his way out of a fucking battle. Joe's not going to be intimidated by anybody. He doesn't need Paul Heyman to back him up. He can back himself up. Nakamura, yes. You know? Nakamura, that's not going to make Nakamura heel if he aligns himself with Paul Heyman. You need a good spokesman. You know? Nakamura lives through his charisma and his facial expressions and his mannerisms. Let that be the thing that gets Nakamura over. And then obviously what he does in the ring. Heyman? He knows Nakamura's history. He knows what Nakamura could be and should be in the WWE. He knows his worth to the company. Let Paul Heyman put his own spin on things and let Nakamura do what he's got to do on his own. Paul Heyman will get Nakamura over with the way he speaks. I would like to see that more so than Joe. Let me know what you guys think about literally everything with this. Very interesting story about Paul Heyman and the rumor of more Paul Heyman guys. And who's to say we might not see a Paul Heyman female down the line? I'd like to see that as well. Damian Sandow discusses why he signed with Impact Wrestling. Now, I watched Impact Wrestling. A lot of people said, JD, you're on TNA. Yeah, I wish. You know, I wish I had a job somewhere doing what I love to do. But Damian Sandow, now under the name Aaron Rex. He looked good. He looked good. I'm happy for him. One of the most underutilized fucking talents WWE has ever had and let go. Now, I don't understand why they let him go. Because the thing that bothers me is that there were reports about WWE having the brand split planned right as 2016 hit. And if this is the case, why wouldn't you keep a more than qualified candidate in Damian Sandow to put on SmackDown and let him get over? He was one of the most popular, if not current guys, most popular on the WWE roster. You made him go out there and people wanted to see him. He was not like a Daniel Bryan, but it was treading that fucking water. People knew that this guy possessed talent. People knew that they were entertained by this guy and they wanted to see more of him. And WWE, again, just like everybody else, that they did not plan on pushing and got over organically. Damian Sandow got over organically. They took everything away from him. They stripped everything away from him that made him who he is. They stripped everything away from him that made him unique. And that fucking bothered me. They took the blue robe. They took the fucking white towel. They took the theme music. They took the pink tights. All of that they took away. And said, fuck you. They gave him nothing but a t-shirt and black trunks. And he was just like anybody else on the roster. That bothered me. Damian Sandow made a unique character for himself, and he propelled himself and catapulted himself into being one of the best heels we've seen in recent memory on WWE. Then he started to get over. And the gimmick that he had as a heel could have easily worked as a babyface. Now you know why he left. Well, he got released, and he has no regrets about being released. WWE released this guy, and we still don't understand why. Because now they're frantically trying to sign people to bolster both Raw and SmackDown. Meanwhile, you had guys on your roster that you let go, that did not want to be there anymore. Cody Rhodes, Damian Sandow, Ryback is another one. I don't give two fucks about Ryback, but he's another helping hand. You know? You didn't want to give him what he was worth, or what he thought he was worth. Fine. But these are guys, bodies, that you can put on a brand and legitimize a brand. Especially with Sandow and Cody Rhodes. Ryback, not too much. But you guys get my point. With the draft, you figure they would have kept guys like Damian Sandow. Now he's in TNA. And I watched TNA this week. Aaron Rex, he recently sat down with Rolling Stone. Signing with TNA. TNA just seemed like the perfect spot for me, Sandow said. Whose real name is Aaron Stevens. When wrestling on the independent circuit, he went by the name Aaron Stevens. They are a growing company with a proven track record. I really believe that their finger is on the pulse of what the audience wants. And they will gear their product towards that. On signing so quickly after departing WWE, I really was not planning on signing with anybody this soon. I was serious about that. But the way the conversations went with several TNA officials and the strong feeling of a family atmosphere really made me want to explore the possibility of getting in the ring sooner than I expected. On his goals with the company, I'm just looking forward to showcasing myself in a way that I have not been able to in the past. There's so much talent in TNA that I just can't name one person that I really want to face over another. It's just a pleasure for me to have creative freedom and continue to work with talented, supportive people. The guard in TNA is changing. And they're making several changes, which I think will be for the better. Now, I don't watch TNA. Joe watches TNA. Joe is heavily involved with TNA. My buddy Joe Corona. He's involved there. He watches it weekly when he can. I don't watch it all that much at all. But I did tune in to this week's Impact. Everybody was tweeting me, JD, Damian Sandow is going to be on there. Teasers are there. Now, I mainly tuned in for fucking Broken Matt Hardy because he is legit my favorite character in all of professional wrestling right now. If it was up to me, Broken Matt Hardy would win the Bound for Glory playoffs and be the new champion. I don't understand why Bobby Lashley has 3 fucking championship belts. I wish somebody would explain to me why they made an executive decision for that to happen. It looks absolutely ridiculous. I mean, Bobby Lashley is not the guy that you want to be building up in that type of way. Why take a belt off this guy, and why take a belt off that guy and put it on Bobby Lashley? He's not going to be wrestling 3 times in one night. He's not going to be defending all belts in one match. I mean, what are they planning to do there? Obviously, Lashley is a talented enough guy that they believe that he is the number one guy in that company. But I don't think he's 3 championships worth the number one guy. Aaron Stevens was there, dropped a pipe bomb of sorts to the TNA Impact Universe. Or whatever the fuck they called him. The TNA Universe. Matt Hardy calls it the TNA Universe. And he looked good. He looked absolutely fantastic. Now, I will say this. He said that anything that he was going to say did not have anything to do with who he was formerly employed with. It had everything to do with who he was formerly employed with. No question. A fucking retard can listen to Aaron Rex talk and realize he was talking about WWE. People knew where he came from. People knew of his situation. And now he's got the creative freedom to do what he wanted to do in WWE, but could not, but now in TNA. And I can't wait to see that happen. Because when I know somebody is wrong, and they want to continually say that they're right, I love when someone can prove that other person fucking wrong and make them look stupid. And I hope Aaron Rex, Aaron Stevens, Damian Sandow, whatever name you want to call him, I hope he makes WWE look stupid. And he said that he was not able to get mic time in that other promotion. I see why. He's too fucking good. He cut a promo as if he was doing this for fucking 30 years. He looked great. Sounded great. Knew what he wanted to say. He didn't stumble over his words. And he even said that where he was formerly employed, it sucks to be everybody there unless you're a hand-chosen top pick number one guy. And everybody knows that they handpick their guys that they want to be the face of that company. And if you work and work and work, your hard work is more than likely going to go unnoticed because you're not a hand-picked guy. So that's why he came to TNA. There's none of this political bullshit in TNA. You go out there, you get over, you show your hard work and your work ethic, and you're going to get rewarded. That's the way that it should be. All this political fucking agenda is nauseating. And for guys like Cody Rhodes and Aaron Rex and Ryback, wherever he ends up, he'll probably end up in TNA as well. He'll probably end up in TNA. TNA is doing the right things after years of doing wrong. After years of battling almost going bankrupt and no money and no support financially. Now they have a new owner. They have a new president in Billy Corgan. Dixie Carter took a step down. You got Broken Matt, who single-handedly took people like me who were not aware of the TNA product and made them watchers. Whether it was for the final deletion, it doesn't matter. I watched, we enjoyed, and we're still paying attention to Matt Hardy. I follow Matt Hardy's Twitter more than I do WWE's Twitter. Because it's entertaining. And he made me a believer in the character. And I listened to the Jericho podcast, and I even fell more in love with Broken Matt Hardy's character. And Jericho even said, if Matt Hardy continues doing what he's doing, striving for success, that it'll be, before you know it, Vince McMahon is giving Matt Hardy a call to come on in. SmackDown is where he should be. I don't think that would get over on Monday Night Raw. I don't think anybody over there, the fucking goons over there on Monday Night Raw, would realize and appreciate and understand what Broken Matt Hardy is and the character. Vanguard 1 and King Maxwell and his wife and Samuel Benjamin, you know? And they don't understand the final deletion. They don't understand that. They took the final deletion and they took it and they spun it into some fucking whack job production with the Wyatt family and the New Day. Pretty much taking what they did genuinely because they love what they're doing. And WWE spun it around into some fucking crazy ass production with no feeling behind it. All because it was the in thing at the time. And it still continues to be the in thing. Matt Hardy, Aaron Rex, Mike Bennett, and a lot of these other guys there. Very talented. Very talented. And you can feel, and I've been very critical of TNA in the past because of who they brought in and the fucking product that they have produced. And still, you know, there's things here and there that I don't like about TNA. There's things here and there I don't like about many things in life. WWE, the place that I work at, certain people, whatever the case may be. But I don't know how you guys feel about TNA, but when I watch TNA, I feel them turning the corner. It may be fucking at turtle speed, but I feel them turning the corner and doing the right thing. They're doing the right thing. And they're continuing to hitting their stride. You know, the audience might not be there immediately, but if they continue putting on good television and word continues to get out and you continue to build off what Broken Matt has done and you brought in Aaron Stevens, who was very, very popular in WWE, you let people know that the former Damian Sandow is now in your company doing what he wanted to do in WWE but could not. This is where you're going to watch him grow. This is where you're going to see the true potential of Aaron Rex, Aaron Stevens, now. Whereas you could not, because he was held behind a fucking curtain, picking grapes and strawberries during catering. TNA is turning a corner. And you feel it. And I am not even a fan of TNA. But I'm not going to sit here and bash them because there's no reason for me to. They're putting on good television. I watched a whole 2-hour Impact this week, unadvertised. It was live, and I enjoyed myself. They need to be live more often. They need to change their announce team. Awful. Things like that. I can't stand watching a taped show. You know it's taped just by the feeling of it. You know? When it's live, you know it's live. That's why I couldn't watch SmackDown when it was taped. Now that it's live, I'll tune in every week. TNA is turning a corner, and you know TNA is making strides to become better than what they were. They're slowly but surely digging themselves out of this black abyss that they've been sitting in for all these years. And I want to see them succeed. I want to see them succeed. I don't think they're going to be competing with WWE. I don't think that should be their priority to compete with WWE. But if they put on good television, at least we'll have another option during the week. Raw, SmackDown, and we watch that religiously every week. We know going in and out of Monday and Tuesday that it's a hit or miss. It is completely 50-50. You get one good show one week, and you get a fucking completely piece of shit show the next week. Then we got NXT on Wednesday. Okay. You guys got your Lucha Underground starting another season, right? Then we got TNA on Thursday. If TNA continues to put on good television, I would not mind covering TNA. And I'm enjoying TNA a little more and more every single week because of what they've done recently. They need to continue that. Do not worry about what anybody else is doing. Worry about what you need to do to get that audience higher and higher and higher and make your talent happy and showcase the talent that you do have. They got talent. Aaron Stevens is just another piece to the puzzle. I think he's going to do very well. And the pipe bomb that he dropped, beautiful. Beautiful. I'm glad TNA let him go out there with an open microphone. And they have the luxury of doing that. They don't give a fuck. Let him go out there. Don't overdo it. Give him bullet points. Make him hit the most important things. And don't overstep your boundaries. And that's exactly what Aaron Stevens did. He kept it simple. Hit the spots he needed to hit. He came out at the end of the main event to stare down Bobby Lashley. Because you know why he's there. He wants one thing and one thing only. To be the TNA World Champion. But he's got to get in line. I think Broken Matt Hardy is the one to be the world champion. I think TNA needs to make Broken Matt the world champion because literally he's the most interesting, engaging, intriguing character they have on television. And the reason why TNA now is gaining more popularity and more eyes on the product is because of what Broken Matt is doing. And you want to give him that much respect. Whereas if this Broken Matt thing didn't take off the way it did, I don't think people would be talking about TNA as much as they are now. No matter who they sign. Broken Matt needs to be world champion, at least until his contract is up. Let him run with the title. Figure it out from there. But TNA, you feel that they're turning a corner, for seriously. They're turning a corner, and I want to see them succeed. So good on them. Great job by Aaron Stevens, signing with TNA. I kind of had a feeling he was going there. Some people said he might have been better in Ring of Honor. Listen, let him be happy. If he's happy, so be it. He's going to be able to do and say the things he wants, whereas he could not in WWE. That's all he wanted. An open mic and a fucking ring to perform in to entertain the people. That's all he wanted. Now he's got that in TNA. Be happy for him. That's it, guys. I'm going to save the Joey Styles story for part 3. There's things I want to go over in this story because literally none of it makes sense. I'm at the point where I'm thinking it's a fucking troll job. And nothing makes sense here. So we'll go over it with a fresh head. And we'll talk about that on part 3. I also got news on Backstage Heat with Sami Zayn for whatever reason. I don't know. We don't know what's going on with Sami Zayn. Update on Finn Balor's Demon King character and what Vince McMahon's reaction to the character is. And then we'll figure out something else, man. But that's all I got right now working for part 3. There's also a story that the Usos right now are not in favor. They're running quickly away from the top spot on Vince McMahon's top tag team list. Vince McMahon reportedly frustrated with top tag team in WWE, the Usos, man. So we'll talk about that, plus so much more. Whatever news breaks, maybe there'll be a part 4. I don't know, but thank you guys so much for listening to me. Thank you all for the continued love and support. If you did enjoy the video and the opinions in this video, hit that thumbs up. Make sure you check the description down below for everything you guys need. T-shirts, Wrestle Crate, Wrestle Rumble, LaBar, and me, 205th. In Brooklyn, August 21st, 4 to 6 p.m. Come and say hello. Call me a fucking goon, whatever the case may be. Sign up for Patreon if you guys want to pledge. Patreon.com/JD from NY206. Follow me on Twitter at JD from NY206 and subscribe to the YouTube channel, the number one fucking podcast in your subscription box is right here on YouTube.com. I'll be back with part three, guys. Hope you enjoyed it. Like I said, hit that thumbs up, and I'll see you right back here on Sunday morning for part three of episode 130.